Good morning, church. Can we stand together as we begin to lift our voices to the Lord? Lord, we come into this place. Purpose to worship you. I pray that you take everything from the day, from the week that might serve as a distraction or a weight, a burden. Help us to lay it at your feet, to trust you. And would you lead us by your Spirit now, I pray. Would you sing with me this? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Bless God. He turned my mourning into dancing, turned my sorrow into joy, song of praise instead of sadness, for my grief the oil of joy. He turned my mourning into dancing, turned my sorrow into joy, song of praise instead of sadness, for my grief the oil of joy. Let me righteousness. verse number one. Once like a bird, it lives and I dwell. No freedom from my sorrow I felt. But Jesus came and he listened to me. Glory to God, he said. Hallelujah. Thank you for setting us free.
Thank you.
Oh, bless God. Bless the name of the Lord our God. Amazing grace will always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my my falling soul. He looked She'll always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why.
Thank you.
yes, we worship Christ the house, gathered in his name to worship him.
We have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, gathered.
As your glory fills this place, you alone. that your glory fills his place. You alone deserve our praise. For the name above all names, be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place, you alone deserve our praise. For the name above all names, be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place, you alone deserve our praise.
A couple of updates that I'd like to give you regarding Israel that you're not going to hear on the news. Earlier this week, commanders were in their whatever command center they were in when another commander was entering into the room. As he entered in, the rest of those that were in charge turned to see him. Their faces were white as a sheet. And he didn't know what they had just viewed. They were watching something on the screen, and a drone had attacked three tanks. So in Gaza, a drone had attacked three Israeli tanks. I think I'm getting some feedback. Could you turn my monitor down, right down, Brian? Please. So three Israeli tanks. Now these ones are transport tanks, not meant primarily for combat. So they transport 12 troops per tank. That means 12 soldiers are in each tank. And with that being the case, there were these three tanks in succession. Well, the lead tank was having trouble with one of its belts on the track. And they decided they needed to evacuate the tank and run for cover because now they can't operate properly. As they got out, the tank behind them noticed them exiting the tank and running for cover. They didn't know what was up, so they stopped and did the same thing. And then the third tank, upon seeing the second tank and not quite being able to make out the first tank, decided to take action the same way, so that all the troops made it to cover before the attack from the drone recorded. And so as they're explaining this, a call came in from one of the tank commanders to say, to report what had just taken place and to let them know all 36 troops were safe and sound, when they had thought they had lost all 36 troops. Praise God for that. So this was a rabbi relating this story and thanking God that God answers prayer. Second one I just received this morning, just did a view it not long before the service began, and that is this. the Israeli soldiers were down in the tunnels, clearing them out of operatives, Hamas operatives, and so basically the enemy. If you're not familiar with who Hamas is the enemy army. When all of a sudden a white dove flew down from a nesting coop higher in the tunnel and perched on a tripwire that they had missed. They didn't see the tripwire, and because the dove landed on the tripwire, they were able to identify this tripwire, and there was enough C4 explosives to level a city block. God is answering prayer. And I'd seen that the Israeli ambassador was in Japan, and those that had received him memorized Psalm 28 verse 11. Psalm 28 and verse 9. I was thinking it was 29 and verse 11. Do you have it there? 28 verse 9. So they learned this in Hebrew, and they sang it for the Israeli ambassador as they were saying that we're trusting God. He's going to shepherd and carry the people of Israel. Praise God. God is at work. If you're getting your news at all about Israel from any of the main news agencies that are in our country, so things like CBC, CTV, ATV, you're not getting the whole picture. And you're going to be getting a picture that is favorable towards Hamas more than it is towards the IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces. If you're seeing positive reports about the Palestinians, turn off the news because it's false. CNN and the likes are giving similar narratives because they are pro-Palestinian. Be careful what you're listening to. Be careful what you give your eyes to, what you get your sources from. Because you're only getting a distorted picture and propaganda concerning Israel, so against Israel, and for the Palestinians. Do you know that it was under 10% of the Palestinians that were surveyed that are against Hamas? Everybody else basically are saying, yeah, way to go, Hamas, for Palestinians. So at least there are some that are not in favor of Hamas and what they're doing. But Hamas is even coming out now with lies, saying that October 7th was the result of Israeli gunfire, that they fired on their own people. Airships came in, helicopters, and massacred them. All the while, they've got thousands of hours of footage that they're wearing. What are those cams called? Body cams. So they're wearing body cams showing the very thing that the world is aware of, what's going on. But we're not even 2 months into this, and already they're denying the events. God is for both people, but the outcome is for Israel. So he's against wickedness. So he's not against the people of Palestine. He's against those who rise up against Israel. And in this instance, it's Hamas. And Hamas never fights fair. Hamas, much of the time, remember, what does Hamas mean? Remember, we looked at it in the scriptures? It's a Hebrew word for what? Evil. Violence. Violence is what it means. So close. Violence. And you'll see many, if there's footage, you'll see many Palestinian soldiers that they're in civilian clothing. And the reason for that is so that they can easily blend in to the rest of the civilian population. And then, pardon me? Yeah, it's a war crime to do that. It's not legal to be a combatant and to be dressed as a civilian. But they do this intentionally so that they can slip in and out easily of the crowds, and then they'll pick up their guns and their RPGs and bazookas and whatever it is that they'll be using for fighting in their combat. They have no regard, no care, or concern for civilians. If you hear differently, it's a lie. And if people tell you differently, tell them you're wrong. Your sources are wrong. Israel is one of the most humane armies in the world. Even at this point, where they're still bombing, still air raids and so on against Gaza, they're still giving opportunity for emergency corridors, for people to leave, the Shifa hospital. They didn't come in guns blazing and so on, like many of news agencies would have you believe. Many Doctors Without Borders, they're not even Palestinian. They're from around the world. They've been there for 15 years. They're saying, no, there's no headquarters. There's no terror tunnel access from the hospital. But they've now conquered. They've gained control of the hospital, and they're showing that different rooms, different buildings of the hospital complex are showing that they have go bags, which are basically all the gear, the tactical gear that they need, and their weapons in order to take quickly and get into the fight. This is right in the hospital itself. And now they're searching for the access routes for the tunnels, because since they knew they were coming, they've been busy with cement and covering over with flower pots and decorations and blending the floor with the floor so that it's harder for them to be able to detect where the entrance to these tunnels are. Continue to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And may it be swift victory. To help you with a little bit, can you visualize how big the country of Israel is? Do you have an awareness of how big it is in relation to other places? Having been there, we can visualize the size of the country. It's so small that the Air Force, when it takes off, it's almost from one end to the other of the country. Once it's airborne, it's like they're flying so fast, they're getting from north to south in just minutes because it's so small. They're going from the eastern border of the Jordan River to the Mediterranean in a matter of seconds, not even minutes. That's how small the country of Israel is. Can you picture how big Nova Scotia is? Can you get an idea of how big Nova Scotia? Anybody driven extensively in Nova Scotia at all? Over here? She's from there. She's got an advantage. We can picture, though, how the kind of size that Nova Scotia is. You can fit more than two nations of Israel in the province of Nova Scotia, the country itself. You can fit two Israels inside of Nova Scotia and have still room to spare. Pardon me? Two and a half Israels in Nova Scotia. That's how tiny this nation is. Incredible. You can fit more than three of them in New Brunswick. So picture this. If Presque Isle or Houlton or Lincoln decided they were going to attack New Brunswick, we're very close to the border. And we'd be hearing air raid sirens and get to your bomb shelters, your safe rooms. If you're out on the roads, here's what happens. You hear that air raid siren. Anybody know what you got to do? If you don't have quick access, you only have 30 seconds to get where you need to be for safety. 30 seconds. And if there's not a bunker nearby, what do you do? Anybody know? You pray. you lay down on the ground, on your face, to try to, so that you're not standing upright. What happens if you're standing upright, if there's shrapnel and so on going on? You'll be cutting too, or you just become a dartboard, really. So it's to minimize. It doesn't mean you won't get any impact, but it means it's to try to minimize the target. Church, we need to pray. These things are still going on. There's still attacks being launched against Israel from the south, from Lebanon in the north. Syria is still attempting to get into all of this. Jordan, the nation of Jordan has decided not to renew the water and power agreement that they've had with Israel for the past decades. Ties are being cut off. The Prime Minister of, is it Prime Minister or President of Turkey? Is it Prime Minister? Prime Minister Erdogan has cut ties with Netanyahu. He says, I will not speak with him any longer. The longer this goes on, church, the tide is going to be turned, of public opinion is going to be turned against Israel like a tidal wave. Do not get swept up in it. Israel will not do everything perfectly. It will not do everything right. But still, this is the nation. This is still the people that God has chosen. So in Genesis chapter 12, the Lord said to Abraham, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. Let's be a blessing to Israel and see God's blessing as we do that very thing. Do not remain silent if you hear people speaking against Israel. Don't remain silent. Silence is complicit, being complicit or in agreement with. Speak up. Speak the truth. You may not know all of the facts, you may not know all of the details, but speak the truth. As much as you are aware of it, speak the truth. Quench the darkness. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together as we go to the Word. Turn with me to John chapter 5. John chapter 5. After this was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool in Aramaic called Bethesda, which has 5 roofed colonnades. And in these lay a multitude of invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be healed?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm going, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, take your bed and walk." And at once the man was healed, and he took up his bed and walked. Now that day was the Sabbath. So the Jews said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath, and it's not lawful for you to take up your bed." But he answered them, "The man who healed me, that man said to me, 'Take up your bed and walk.'" They asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk'?" Now the man who had been healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn, as there was a crowd in the place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you." The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. And this was why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, "My Father is working until now, and I am working." This was why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Church, this is the very word of God. Thank God for his word. And Lord, we do that very thing. Thank you for blessing us with this treasure. Lord, would you lead us? Give us understanding. Holy Spirit, lift Jesus high, I pray. I know that's your purpose, your desire. May it be accomplished during our time here that is left. We thank you for it. We ask this in the strong name of the Son of God, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. The title of my message is Grace Flows Like a River. This pool of Bethesda was located just north of the temple. It would be located just on the outside of what was the old city walls. The old city meaning the old city of David, not the old city in the time of Jesus. Jesus could have gone anywhere in Jerusalem. Now he's coming there from Galilee. When he arrives, he goes directly to and specifically for this man. He goes to the pool of Bethesda. Now, the pool has a Jewish or an Aramaic name. But the pool was built by the Greeks, or by the Romans, excuse me, and carried the name from the Greeks, a false god, a god of healing, and a god that they would say was able to raise the dead. His name was Asclepius. And this pool, this building that they were in, was called an Asclepion, meaning it was a healing place, a place intended for healing. They had priests of this religion that would be there to attend to the needs of the people. But they weren't able to do the miraculous, although it went by the name of this god, this demigod. So Jesus comes onto the turf, if you will, of a rival god. Now, no god is truly a rival to Jesus, are they? But he would be stated as such, or he would be evaluated as a rival to Jesus, or Jesus a rival to Asclepius. Asclepius is part of mythology. Not truly a god. But Jesus is God in the flesh. And he comes to this place where there was a tradition that when the waters were stirred up, they believed it was an angel that was doing this stirring of the waters, and the first one to get into the water, they believed, would be healed. Jesus comes to this place with this tradition, to this man who has been an invalid for how long? 38 years. If you look up 38 years in a concordance, and especially in a digital device, to be able to search 38 years, you're going to get two results. One will be here, and the other one will be found in Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse 14. I believe that the Spirit of God is giving us this account through the the quill, the pen, if you will, of John. And giving us the details that this man had been an invalid for 38 years. Not that he'd been an invalid for a long time, or that he'd been an invalid for years and years, or for almost three decades, Literally, it says he'd been an invalid for how long? 38 years. See, this is a picture of Israel. It's a picture of all those who have not yet entered into the promises of God. How so? Well, I mentioned that this amount of years, 38 years, found here and again in Deuteronomy chapter 2 and 14. Would you turn with me for a moment to that place if you've not done so yet? We find this out. Deuteronomy 2 and verse 14. And the time from our leaving Kadesh Barnea until we crossed the brook Zered was 38 years, until the entire congregation, that is the men of war, had perished from the camp as the Lord had sworn to them. Because indeed the hand of the Lord was against them to destroy them from the camp until they had perished. What's the context? Well, first of all, Moses is the one speaking here. He's the one who's recording this event. They are just little more than a month or two away from entering into the promised land. Moses is just about to die. So he's recapping for the nation of Israel what has gone on for these past 40 years since coming out of Egypt. The purpose of this 38 years is this. From the time of our leaving Kadesh Barnea until we crossed the brook Zered was 38 years. Zered just happened recently. It's just happened just a short time prior to this. So he's saying from Kadesh Barnea, that event there, until now is 38 years. But what happened at Kadesh? Well, there's been a few things that happened at Kadesh, but what he's referencing specifically is found back in Numbers chapter 13. Would you come with me there for a moment to Numbers 13? And we're not doing an extensive survey, and we're not going to spend a great deal of time in all of these passages, but I want us to see what is taking place for context. So we're in Numbers chapter 13. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, send men to spy out the land of Canaan, which I'm giving to the people of Israel. And then he gives instruction to choose one from each of the heads of the 12 tribes of Israel. And numbered among them were two men, and we know is Caleb and Joshua. Now, Joshua's name, up until this point, is Hosea. And Moses gave him the name Joshua. Their purpose was to go and spy the land of Canaan, come back and bring back a report. Now, how long were they in the land? Here's a little bit of testing for us this morning. What's our Bible knowledge like? How long were they in the land spying it out before they came back? 40 days. And when they came back with a report. They said the land is indeed fruitful and abundant. As a matter of fact, look what we have. And they brought back great abundance and display of evidence of the produce of the land, not least of which was the grapes, the clusters of grapes that they had to carry on a pole between two men, that pole braced on their shoulders, among some other produce that they brought with them. They said it is productive, it is fruitful, but it is also a land of giants. And it devours its inhabitants. In other words, it's not a good place to be. 10 of them brought back this report that we can't go in because there's giants there, and we were like grasshoppers in our own eyes and theirs. So they esteemed themselves to be like grasshoppers. But there were two voices saying, no, let us go in. God has promised he will do it. with many or with few. It doesn't matter with God. It's not us. It's not our strength. It's not our number. It's God. It's about Him. When we look at chapter 13 and further down, we look at verse 26. After the end of 40 days, and they returned from spying out the land, they came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the people of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at what location? Kadesh. All right, so it's that Kadesh, and it's that event at Kadesh that Moses is referring to in Deuteronomy chapter 2. From the time we left Kadesh until we crossed over the river, the Zered, it has been 38 years. Why does he give that detail? Why is he telling us that it's been 38 years? Because if you look throughout chapter 14 of Numbers, we find out that the people of Israel, they believed the negative report that was given to them at, the location again is Kadesh, also known as Kadesh Barnea. So same place, fuller name. One is shortened to Kadesh, otherwise known as Kadesh Barnea. They said, we can't go in because they'll kill us. Our children will be destroyed. Then the Lord brought judgment upon them and said, because you refuse to believe my word, I'm bringing judgment against you so that you will be in this wilderness 1 year for each day the spies were in the land. So for each day, you will be in this wilderness a year for a day, that meaning for a total of 40 years. The people of Israel, at hearing this, they're like, oh no, and they decided, we'll go up against them. We'll fight against the Amalekites. And Moses said, don't go or you will be destroyed, because God has not sanctioned this battle. Not at this point, because of your rebellion. They went up anyway. They were devastated. They were defeated. The Lord said that your children that you were afraid would be devoured in the land are the ones that are going to go into the land. And all of you who are 20 years of age and older, from fighting age and up, will die in this wilderness. And the last one of you to die will then make way for your children to go in to the land. So they'd already been in the wilderness for 2 years. They were at Mount Sinai for a year when they were getting all the instructions and so on for the tabernacle and the construction thereof. And then after they'd been there for a year, they began going from one place to another. And at the end of the second year, the Lord brought them to Kadesh. So they could have been in the promised land just after being in the wilderness for only 2 years. The Lord says it'll be for 40 years, but he'd already counted, commuted their sentence, sort of an idea. We're already served 2 years. There's 38 more to go. And why were they in the wilderness for 38 more years? The scripture tells us because of their unbelief. So Kadesh has this picture then for the people of Israel as a place of unbelief, of disbelief, if you will. Today, if you hear his voice, do not rebel like they did. Do not harden your hearts like they did when they rebelled and said, no, we're not going up. And then they said, we will, after the Lord said, you're not. That was one of the main events at Kadesh that stick out. But as you go ahead to Numbers chapter 19, you discover that we're at the end of those 38 more years, or what in total would be coming on to the end of the 40 years. So that at this point, we've got, they're in their 39th year, and Miriam dies at Kadesh. They come back to Kadesh a number of years later. It was verse 20, or chapter 20, I'm sorry, that she dies. But I want you to notice what else happens. After Miriam dies in Kadesh, Numbers chapter 20, the people are complaining they don't have water. Moses goes to the Lord. Look at verse 6. Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly to the entrance of the tent of meeting and fell on their faces. And the glory of the Lord appeared to them. Now picture this. Moses and Aaron have been leading the people of Israel now for 40 years, almost 40 years. And there's been complaints, and there's been murmuring, and there's been grumblings. But here we are with the younger generation, the newer generation, and they've learned it from their parents, and they're continuing it on because they're almost at the end of those 40 years, the fullness of the 40 years. And now they're the grumblers. They're the complainers. But I praise God that even in spite of our grumbling and complaining at times, that He still pours out grace. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Take the staff and assemble the congregation, you and Aaron, your brother. Tell the rock before their eyes to yield its water. So you shall bring water out of the rock for them and give drink to the congregation and their cattle." It's an amazing thing that God would hear their cries, hear their murmurings, their complaints, but He still was gracious to them. And the instruction that the Lord gives to Moses and Aaron was, go to the rock and speak to it. This sounds vaguely familiar if you're in Israel. Some of them might have been old enough to remember what happened 40 years earlier after they left, and they're holding their parents' hands, and they're just little people. They're younger than 20 years of age. And they remember, some of them vaguely, some more clearly than others. Some who might have remembered it more clearly than others, still it's 40 years in the past. So maybe not all of the details are vivid. But in Exodus chapter 17, they're coming out of Egypt, and the Lord says, go to the rock that stands before you, the rock at Horeb, and you're to do this. Take the staff that is in your hand and strike the rock with the staff, in Exodus 17, 40 years earlier. Strike the rock. Moses did so, and what happened? Water gushed out, watering all of the people and all of their cattle and all of their livestock, all of their herds. Here we are now 40 years later, where we need water. There's no water. Here we are. We're parched. And the glory of the Lord, the presence of the Lord, appears to Moses and to Aaron. Here's what you're to do. Take the staff and speak to the rock. Tell the rock to release its water. Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock, and he said to them, now pay attention to what Moses says. This is what he says to the people. Hear now, you rebels. Did the Lord tell him to speak thusly? He said, shall we bring water for you out of this rock? Moses has got the wrong perspective. Who's the one bringing water out of the rock? It's God and God alone. Yet he says, shall we bring water out of the rock? As though the source is in him, or the ability is in him and his brother Aaron. But it's not. Moses and Aaron, they in their anger, they're sinning. They're exasperated by the conduct of the people of Israel. Moses lifted up his hand and he struck the rock with his staff twice. What do we see here? What's wrong? He was told to tell the rock to release its water. But instead of speaking to the rock, he struck it. He didn't even strike it while he said, "Water, yield," or "Rock, yield your water." He doesn't speak it while he strikes it. He simply strikes it. I can picture him. I don't know how he did it. He might have taken it with one hand and struck it this way. He might have taken it like a baseball bat, as we would know it today, and strike it. And he does so twice. And God, he just stands there. He stands there. And God in his mercy, God in his grace, what does he do? He does not withhold the water. He causes water to gush from the rock. It came out how? In a trickle? It came out abundantly. In other words, it gushed out. And the congregation drank and their livestock. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not believe in me to uphold me as holy in the eyes of the people of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land that I am giving them." Because I hit the rock instead of speaking to it? Church, we need to see that they were not magnifying the Lord in the people's eyes. They were shrinking the Lord in the people's eyes. They were misrepresenting the Lord, as if to say that the Lord has headed up to here with you and he is done. And in his exasperation, he's going to give you water, but it's reluctantly. That's really what Moses and Aaron are saying. But that's not what God said. It's a misrepresentation of what God commanded them to do, and a misrepresentation of his character. Now, has God said in the past, "You are a stiff-necked people"? Yes. Are they being a stiff-necked people now? Yes. But God, still in our stiff-neckedness, is that a word? In our being stiff-necked, stubborn, God still pours out his grace, even in the case where there may be rebuke or correction or instruction. He still pours out his grace like a river. Moses and Aaron were prevented from going in to the land of Canaan, the land that God had promised to their forefather, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But there's even a fulfillment in that, because Moses was a representation of what? The law. And the law cannot bring liberty. The law cannot bring freedom. The law is capable of serving as a mirror. It can instruct us. But it cannot put a heart in us to follow the law, to receive its instruction. So as it is, the law is the capability of pointing out our shortcomings, our sin. But it can't bring anything of a change regarding our sin. So the law, as it were, wasn't able to bring the people of Israel into the promises of God. The law could only point them that's where the promises are to be found. And who leads them into the promised land? Joshua, whose name is shared with our Savior. Jesus and Joshua. It's the same name, one from the Hebrew and the other from the Greek. And Joshua leads them into the promises. Even as 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 19 and 20 says that all of the promises of God are yes and amen. They find their fulfillment in whom? Jesus Christ. So do you see these two big events that take place at Kadesh? And there's a spanning of how many years between these two events? 38 years. That brings us back to John chapter 5. There's this man, he's at this pool of Bethesda. It has as his overseer Asclepius, this false god. And it's got a Hebrew, it's got a Jewish name, it's got an Aramaic name, Bethesda. What does it mean? What does Bethesda mean? Bet means house. Esda is of kindness or of mercy. It comes from the Hebrew word, you'll recognize this, chesed. Do you recognize that word? Chesed, which means loving kindness. Perhaps your translation will render it as mercy. Give thanks to the Lord, Psalm 136. It has probably chesed more than any other chapter. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy, his loving kindness, his chesed endures forever. His chesed endures forever. This place where this man is laying, hoping that he will somehow be able to get into this water once this mythological, if you will, the superstition that an angel comes down and stirs the water, once it starts bubbling, maybe I'll be the first one in. But alas, anytime it happens, he isn't able to. Little do they realize that because it's a pool, that there's two pools, one an upper pool and one a lower pool, and those that are in charge of the waters, when they release some of the water from the upper pool to the lower pool, what happens to the waters? Is an angel involved at all? No. This is just a transfer of water from an upper pool to a lower pool, and superstition that has arisen because of Asclepius. There's healing involved, or supposed to be. There's this hope in some superstition. But here's Jesus. Now he comes and he meets this man where he's at his point of need. And we're told that he is an invalid, has been an invalid for 38 years. The only other time 38 is mentioned is brought back to the history of Israel when they're between the Red Sea and the Promised Land, coming into the promises. Jesus sees him, and this man, he looks at Jesus. Jesus said, "Do you want to be made well?" Isn't that a strange question, do you think, for somebody who's been 38 years an invalid? We don't know how long he's been coming or being taken to this place for healing. Does that strike you as a strange question? Do you want to be healed? Why does Jesus ask him, "Do you want to be healed?" Because there are times in our history that we grow comfortable in what we've learned and adapted to. In our deficiencies, we've learned how to adapt to those things, and we're not sure how we would manage if we got freedom from those things. How do I function? There are those psychologists that have done studies, that some who have received their hearing back after living a lifetime without being able to hear, or those who all of a sudden through some treatment or procedure have been able to get vision after losing it as a child perhaps, and now able to see as an adult, that they have information overload and they will oftentimes close their eyes or put stoppers on their ears, going back to what they once knew, because that's how things work for them. And I think what Jesus is asking here is this: not just, do you want to be made well? That's an obvious question, an obvious answer to an obvious question. I think it's Jesus is saying, are you willing to put your trust in me and not in all of these superstitions? And the man doesn't quite get the gist of what Jesus is saying, because he says, I have no man to let me into the water. There's no one, I have nobody that will let me into the water when it's stirred. While I'm trying to get there, somebody gets there ahead of me. Jesus doesn't get into a debate with him, does he? He simply makes a command. Get up. Rise up. And I want us to stop there for a moment. He says, rise up, get up. What is Jesus telling the man to do? He's telling the man to do the impossible. Can this man get up? If somebody else said to him, get up, could he do it? It's not possible. because he does not have the capability of rising up. But because Jesus speaks the words, because Jesus gives the command, get up, rise up, in some translations, rise up. What comes to mind when you hear that command, rise up? It's a command of life. It's a command of resurrection from the dead. Rise up. This man is not capable of rising up in his own strength. The similar idea you'd see when Jesus was at, in John chapter 9, when he's at the tomb of Lazarus. Lazarus, come forth. It's a similar idea. Rise up. Come, do what you are not in your own strength, in your flesh, are not able to do. But I am. I'm going to raise you up. I'm going to raise you up. Where is this man right now? He's in the house of mercy. Not only does it mean the house of mercy, the house of grace, it speaks of a house of abundance, a house of overflow, a house of flowing water, are different translations of this word, Bethesda. But it's a house not only of these things, but it's known as the house of Asclepius. Asclepius is the one who rules here. He calls the shots. He's the one that we believe is able to raise the dead. But no, he's not. Jesus shows that he alone has the power to raise the dead, to deal with those things that are dead. His body was dead, as it were, incapable of doing what Jesus is commanding him to do. Get up, rise up. And because the author of life, the Lord of glory, speaks the words, now life, healing, wholeness comes in to this man's body, so that he's able to do what he was formerly unable to do in his own strength, because his own strength was strengthlessness. Take up your mat and go home. Why does he tell him to take up his mat and go home? Why take up his mat? Well, we're told that this was a Sabbath. We're told, how long did it take for this man to be healed, for him to be whole? Immediately. At once, the man was healed. God doesn't do partial healings. God heals or he doesn't heal. And this man takes up his mat, his bed, and he's making his way home, but en route he stops at the temple. Before he gets to the temple, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they say to him, why are you carrying your mat on the Sabbath day? He tells them what takes place. A man told me to take up my mat and go home. Jesus didn't even stop to tell him, I am Jesus, the Son of God. But Jesus doesn't leave somebody hanging so that they can be caught up in some other half-truth or mythology. Or when I say half-truth, really a half-truth is no truth at all, right? It is truth, some truth mixed in to try to give it some kind of validity. But Jesus does not leave those who have been given the light just to fend for themselves. He didn't know who it was who healed him, but we're told that Jesus found him a little later on at the temple. Notice it doesn't say that the man found Jesus, but Jesus found him. Coincidence? Was this a coincidence? Church, this was not a coincidence. Jesus allowed this man to have the encounter with these religious leaders and then be brought to him. He found the man and told him who he was. See, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you. Is this the only thing that Jesus said to the man? This is what's recorded for us. But we do know there must have been more interaction that had taken place, because after the man leaves, he goes and tells the Jews that it was Jesus. Jesus healed me. It had nothing to do with superstition. It had nothing to do with any of these things that I've been waiting for. It was this man, and his name is Jesus. And that's why the Jews got in their minds, we got to destroy this Jesus. He's been creating a stir and making a mess, and here he is. They didn't care this man was healed, did they? They're only concerned, why are you carrying your mat, your bed, on the Sabbath day? And why did Jesus do this on the Sabbath instead of yesterday, the sixth day, or tomorrow, which is the first day of the week, which wouldn't have riled or rattled the Jews, the religious leaders, at all? Why on the Sabbath? Because Jesus is the fulfillment of the law. He's fulfilled every aspect of the law, so that in that we can rest. We can rest. We can't do anything to find rest in God. It's only through Jesus. See, this man was a picture of their unbelief. Unbelief. They chose to disbelieve God. And now, here is God in the flesh, and he's appearing even in his works. And they refuse to believe he is who he says he is. Some people would say that Jesus never claimed to be God. And where there may be any doubt or wondering or naysaying that Jesus claimed to be God, the Jews are there to tell us, to help us out. It says this was why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Because Jesus answered them and said, my Father is working until now, and I am working. Church, what Jesus is saying, there's never a time that God is not at work. He's always working to bring people to freedom, always working to bring people to truth. We need to be careful that we don't get so engaged with the scriptures that we only carry it, or we only read them without an eye and a heart to obey them, without an eye and a heart to receive them. Because having the Word of God but not reading it is useless to us. Reading the Word of God and not responding in obedience to the Word of God creates hardness in hearts. Somebody can be the most diligent, often, reader of the scriptures, but if their heart is not open to receive the word, to respond to the word of God, our hearts will be turned off. Our hearts will be hardened. What's the most dangerous place that you can be on the planet? Where is the most dangerous place you can be? Any votes? Some might say, well, maybe in Gaza right now. It's a pretty dangerous place. Wouldn't want to be in Iran as a Christian and be discovered for fear of what they might do. What's the most dangerous place in the world to be, though? Is it those places or places like them? I present to you that the most dangerous place to be in the world is the opening of the Word of God, but the closing of the heart, the closing of the ears. Because when the Word is opened and our hearts are closed, then we can become hardened to the Word of God. That's the most dangerous place we can be. And this man, he was a symbol of unbelief. He didn't believe. He's there chasing superstitions, mixed in with his Jewish observance, and observance of whatever observance of the law. Because where does Jesus find him later? He's at the temple. But we see that what is of greater truth, what is of greater strength, is not this this mythology, this superstition, but it's the very house in which this man was located that Jesus came and found him in. He was in the house of mercy, and then he went to the house of God, which is really the same place, isn't it? He was in the went to the temple. That's where Jesus found him. Jesus went looking, searching for him. It wasn't that this man had gotten away from Jesus. He said, where did he go? Jesus knew where to find him as he was being led by the Spirit. Jesus, fully God. And church, he knows our situation. He knows where we are at. And he's come to bring liberty to us, whatever place we find ourselves in. If there's lack of belief in Jesus, to do a something in our situation, or to change our hearts, or to bring the Word of God alive to us, he's come to set us free. He's come even in spite of the fact where we may have abused the Word, neglected, rejected, ignored. He still comes and pours out living water, still an abundance of water of himself. Paul says that the rock followed them, that same spiritual rock followed them, and that rock, this was in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and that rock was Christ, was Jesus. Why did God tell Moses to strike the rock and then 40 years later, a different rock, but still a picture of Jesus, tell him to speak to it? Was because the first time was a picture of Jesus being struck at the cross. Speaks of his death, his sacrifice, his crucifixion. And then why did he tell him to speak to the rock 40 years later? Was because Jesus was crucified how many times for the sin of mankind? Once for all, and now all we need to do is speak. Speak, and he listens. And that's why God held Moses and Aaron to such a high account, high standard, was because they did not uphold the Lord as holy in the sight of the people. Striking the rock, misrepresenting the Lord and misrepresenting Christ to the people. And the Lord says, no, we don't strike the rock now. We don't have to, church, we don't come to Jesus say, please do this for me, like we can strike and get the water to come out. We come to Jesus and we find the water is already in abundance. I believe that Jesus would come to us this morning and say, I see you at your point of need. Whatever it is that we would see a deficiency in, whatever we would see something that's weak in and of ourselves, that we can't do something that God has called us to do, he's saying to us, rise up. I am the resurrection. I am the author of life. I am the one who gives power where you have no power. Do we have weakness in our hearts to obey the Word of God? Do we have weakness in our hearts to come to the Word of God? When we come to the Word of God, is it just a matter of duty? Okay, I've got my several verses in, or I got my chapter read. Do we love the Word of God? Church, do you love the Word of God? Not the right answer, but the real answer. We know what the right answer is. The right answer is love the Word of God. But do we love the Word of God? What's the real answer? Do we love the Word of God? Is it exhibited in our lifestyle, in the way we live? And I can't help but seeing Jesus say, rise. Rise up. Take up your mat. Go home. I'm bringing rest to you. I'm going to take away the duty part of it. I'm going to take away the work part of it, the drudgery part of whatever it is that the Lord has been calling us to and we've been reluctant or hesitant to step into because we felt powerless, like no strength. We've wrestled with something of obedience. And Jesus is speaking to us, rise up. Rise up, walk in my strength. Walk in my strength, even when we can't see him. Did did the man, when Jesus disappeared into the crowd for the purpose of meeting up with him in just a little while, did the man, once Jesus was out of sight, did the man all of a sudden go, oh, did he lose his strength? He continued to walk in strength that was now his, but it didn't belong to him. It was his that was imparted to him by Jesus. So even when we can't, when it feels like we can't see him, feels like we can't feel him. Have you been there? Feels like God is far from me. Anyone ever been to that place? It feels like God is far away. Feels like my prayers are not even making it to the ceiling, or if they are, they're bouncing back down. Anyone ever, could those words be used to describe you at some time? Could it be used to describe you now? He never leaves us. And our prayers don't have to get through the ceiling to get to him, because he is with us. Even when we don't see him, Jesus said, my Father is working, and I am working with him. He's always at work, church, no matter what it is you've been praying for. And you see, there's no strength, there's no life in this. Trust him. Trust him. If he's leading you in a prayer, a spirit-led prayer is always a spirit-answered prayer. And it's because of this abundance of grace that flows like a river. And if we've sinned, if we've rebelled, he is quick. He seeks us out. He's quick to follow after us, to restore us. So let's receive that refreshing, abundant river of grace, of mercy, of hesed, the loving kindness of God, as we find ourselves living in a house called mercy, a house called grace. We just stand before him now and say, Lord, I need your grace. I need your mercy. Whatever your circumstance is, what area of your life are you experiencing being an invalid? And the Lord wants to bring strength to you today. Would you give it to the Lord and say, Lord, here it is. Where I'm powerless, would you heal me? Make me strong to walk in your strength. Or would you help us where we would have a disbelief? If something may have been a certain way or a certain experience for such a long time, we feel like it can't change. I thank you the time or duration of an event or a situation or a condition does not render you powerless. It doesn't make it more difficult for you to bring about the remedy, to bring life. Because if it's dead, it's dead. It's not going to get deader than it is now. And Lord, you speak life to the lifeless. You speak hope to the hopeless. You restore us. Thank you, Lord, for this river of grace. Your love and care for us, your concern. We give thanks to you, Lord. Because this loving kindness endures forever. prayers that have gone prayed 100 times, 1,000 times, and seeing no change. Lord, may we not lose heart, knowing that you are the one who brings life. Who heals. Bless your name. Bless your most holy name, Lord. Amen.